This is only the second time in history that Pad 39B at the Kennedy Space Center has prepared to host a launch to the moon. The only other flight to do so was the Apollo 10 dress rehearsal for the first lunar landing. For SLS, the final major configuration of the vehicle takes place with fueling operations, to load approximately 730,000 gallons of liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen into the core stage. Join us as we bring you, after years of development and delayed SLS launch, NASA definitely need to address the issue. Monday's launch attempt resulted in a scrub, due to an issue with one sensor, on one of four liquid hydrogen bleed lines. That transfer LH2 into the engines, as part of their thermal conditioning into their appropriate start temperature range, known as the start box. On Monday, the faulty sensor on the core stage bleed line for engine 3, returned a temperature higher than other sensors, located in the engine and higher than liquid hydrogen should be for the system. NASA has scrubbed the second launch attempt of the Artemis 1 mission, from the Kennedy Space Center, in Florida. After a liquid hydrogen leak was detected at the vehicle-to-ground interface. On the liquid hydrogen tail service mast umbilical. This was the fourth time teams loaded liquid hydrogen on the vehicle, and the fourth time, something in the LH2 tail service mast umbilical leaked hydrogen. The mission management team is meeting to address the situation. However, numerous sources indicate that the only real option is to roll back to the vehicle assembly building to investigate the leak source. Before targeting the next available lunar launch window that, from a timing perspective, is likely the one that opens on October 17. This mismatch and the need to fully understand what was happening and confirm that the single sensor was indeed the one malfunctioning resulted in the scrub. After officially calling off Monday's attempt, the SLS launch team kept the vehicle fueled to gather as much data as possible on the issue. This process provided the data needed for the team to have confidence that all four RS-25 engines reached their start box temperature range on Monday and that all data points from the engines themselves are good and valid. For Saturday's attempt, the team will monitor the sensor they believe to be bad and compare it with data from the engines themselves. Should the same issue with the core stage bleed line sensor for engine 3 reoccur Saturday, launch teams will look at all data points and are expected to simply ignore that faulty sensor. The sensor in question is not a flight instrument or development flight instrument, but rather used for engineering analysis. As such, this is not a sensor used by the computer systems on the ground and rocket to verify vehicle health. This major operation began with chill down of the liquid oxygen and liquid hydrogen transfer lines and the propulsion lines in the core stage. As the wet dress rehearsal campaign showed, the fueling operation is complex and must follow a specific sequence. Specifically, so that the liquid oxygen core stage tank is no more than 50% full by the time liquid hydrogen loading begins. This has to do with the thermal and mass characteristics of the core stage. This process was seen during the wet dress rehearsal campaigns, when liquid hydrogen leaks forced a stop to liquid oxygen loading. As LH2 loading enters fast fill operations, teams closely monitored the purge can in the LH2 tail service mast umbilical that leaked during Monday's attempt. No leak reappeared here on the September 3rd attempt. Heading into the final part of the count in the morning hours of September 3rd. The Exploration Ground Systems launch team were cautiously optimistic that the liquid hydrogen leaks had been addressed. This proved to not be the case. Core stage fueling was to be followed by interim cryogenic propulsion stage, fueling with liquid hydrogen and liquid oxygen. With the ICPS being the last portion of the vehicle to be fueled for flight. However, before tanking operations begin, teams needed to successfully transition from air purge over to gaseous nitrogen purge. Issues establishing this nitrogen purge during the wet dress rehearsal campaigns resulted in the launch team extending the hold before fueling. This added time worked as intended on Monday and Saturday, and no issues with the gaseous nitrogen changeover were noted on either launch attempt. During this period, as propellants were to be flowing into the vehicle, thermal conditioning of the four RS-25 core stage engines was to commence 45 minutes earlier than during Monday's attempt. The team never got to this point on Saturday. This lengthy process would ensure the engines are within the proper start box at the end of the countdown. The four RS-25 engines on Artemis I were still in service at the end of the shuttle program. But for Artemis I, at least one component on each of the core stage engines comes from the three engines that powered Columbia to orbit on STS-1 on April 12, 1981. It might be a valve, it might be a bolt, for others, it's pieces of wiring, little things like that, said Aerojet Rocketdyne's Bill Muddle, RS-25 lead field integration engineer, in an interview with NASA Spaceflight. But there is something from the STS-1 engines on each of these for Artemis 1. Some changes to the engines, for fit and function on SLS have resulted in a slight change to their ignition timing from shuttle. Muddle confirmed that the engines will start 120 milliseconds apart from each other, for acoustic and vibration considerations just as they did in the shuttle era. 10 seconds before engine start, nearly 400,000 gallons of water would have begun dumping into the flame trench of LC-39B and the RS-25, and solid rocket booster flame holes in the mobile launcher. 6 seconds before engine start, the hydrogen burn-off igniters would have fired across the plane of the RS-25 engine nozzles and upward at the core stage auxiliary power unit exhaust ports. This would have ensured that excess hydrogen was safely burned off before the engine started, and that any hydrogen was safely burned off should there have been an engine shutdown and abort on the pad. From engine start down to T0, the engines will build up to 100% rated performance thrust within 3 seconds. After which health checks will confirm the engines are good for the next major event that commits the vehicle to flight, solid rocket booster ignition. At T0, a rapid sequence of events will trigger the swing arms to move away from the vehicle, for the tail service mast fueling and data lines to pull back into their protective doghouse covers, and for the final fire sequence command to be sent to light the SRBs. The moment the boosters ignite, SLS is committed to lifting off the pad under its own 8.8 million pounds of thrust. SLS will rise vertically off its mobile launcher perched atop LC-39B for 7 seconds, before the pitch and roll program will maneuver the rocket onto the proper azimuth for its flight to the moon. This first stage of flight will see SLS utilize an open-loop guidance system, where the rocket follows a pre-programmed pitch profile based on its velocity, altitude, and initial orbital insertion targets. After constantly changing its pitches required to reach the desired orbit, an attitude hold will be commanded on the SLS rocket, just before the first major event in the launch sequence, SRB separation. At approximately T+2:12, the twin five-segment SRBs from Northrop Grumman will separate from the core stage, having done their job. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, to make sure you can subscribe. If you have any crazy idea what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we will see if we can get the, and thanks again for watching and goodbye.